Good morning, my yeasties!
Hope you all are having a wonderful day. Come with us to lab. Today we're going to take you with us on an adventure and show you how to do a complementation test with our favorite model organism, yeast. Sorry, Drosophila, maybe don't fly away next time.
So we start off our days strolling up Science Hill because there's nothing better than blissfully watching pre-meds rushing to make it to Org on time. Anxiety works better than caffeine.
Walking into the lab, we make sure to abide by all EHS rules because compliance is how we made it this far. So why stop now?
Now it's time for the only part of the day that matters, complementation testing. This is not a new dating strategy, but if it works for you, you won't yuck your yum. And now we're going to show you how it works.
Complementation is used to determine where specific genes are located in relation to each other. Basically, it helps us figure out if certain mutant alleles are in the same gene or if they are in different genes, which helps us understand which genes are responsible for producing a phenotype of interest.
Yeast is super useful as a demonstration of this genetics concept because they can exist in haploid and diploid forms. We start with homozygous recessive mutations that are haploid, meaning they only contain one copy of each gene. How do we know that they are mutant?
They have this red mutant phenotype, while the normal wild-type phenotype of yeast is a creamy white. Each of these haploid mutants possesses a recessive mutation in their respective mutated genes, one in the ADD1 gene and the other on the ADD2 gene.
Mutant genes in the adenine biosynthesis pathway cause the typical white wild-type yeast cells to appear red. We'll cross these haploid yeast cells with each other to produce diploid cells using a technique called streaking. And no, not that kind! Get your mind out of the gutter!
If the progeny from the cross are still red, then we can say that those recessive mutations fail to complement, which means that they are in the same complementation group and likely on the same gene.
And if the progeny from the cross are white, then we rescue the mutant phenotype. In that case, the recessive mutations complement each other. Isn't that nice? So those mutations are likely located on different genes. Yeah.
Let's take a look at this plate. This is my finished complementation plate from when we did this test last month. Here we're crossing parent strains, specifically HB1 and HB2, with HA1 and HA2 strains. HB1 and HA1 have mutations on the ADD1 gene. HB2 and HA2 have mutations on the ADD2 gene. All the parent strains are haploid and have pink or red phenotypes. Later, we'll touch upon the tester strains, XA1 and XA2.
The cross between HB1 and HA1 produced red progeny, whereas the cross between HB1 and HA2 produced white progeny. For HB2, the cross with HA1 produced white progeny, whereas the cross with HA2 produced red progeny. These colors match our expectations. Haploid yeasts that possess mutations that are on different genes will complement each other, each providing the other a functional copy of the gene that was mutated in their partner, thus rescuing the mutant phenotype. They are therefore located on different genes, which is what we see in crosses between HB1 and HA2, as well as HB2 and HA1.
Mutations that failed to complement each other resulted in diploid progeny that still expressed the mutant phenotype. We can see this being the case when we crossed HB1 with HA1 and when we crossed HB2 with HA2.
Now let's take a look at the tester strains, XA1 and XA2. The HB1-XA1 cross resulted in a red phenotype, which means that they failed to complement and are on the same gene. The HB2-XA2 cross had the same phenotypic result.
The HB1-XA2 cross resulted in a white phenotype, so they do complement each other and are on different genes. The HB2-XA1 cross had the same phenotypic result.
The crosses that resulted in red progeny are in the same complementation group, while white progeny are in different complementation groups.
Using the phenotypes of the progeny discussed and the genotypes for each parental strain, we can conclude that the two tester strains, XA1 and XA2, were ADD1 and ADD2.
Woo! That was a hard day's work in genetics lab, now that we finished.
It's time for us to recharge by taking that sweet smell of SCL. Refreshing!
Thanks for following us, and stop following us repeatedly, because that counts as stalking.
Toodles!